So this is the philosophy of multi-cavity tooling, right? And that's quite common, like I said, when you're doing number of parts, they don't all have to be identical, but as long as their overall geometry, shape, etc. are manageable. Also notice that the points of these are, there's narrowing at this point right here, right? Which actually is required when you are doing neat plastics, and that is required because that's where you can, the part can be cut off, right? And that's, you always get a small impression of it. Like here, if you look carefully on the back of the bottle, you see there's a small dot there. So that dot is where the gate was disconnected from the part, right? Of course, in blow molding, they first make the parison and then they blow the parison. So the injection molded parison has that small dot on it. So the point here to note is this is, of course, all this is when you're doing neat plastics. What happens if the plastic has fibers that are suspended in it? I mean, if it's compounded fibers or fiber reinforced, then this type of gates don't work well. Why not? Because the fibers will want to first clog in that small gap right there. So you can only load so much. There's a effect of filtration where the resin wants to keep going and the fibers want to stay back. So you may get separation of the melt from the fibers. So there's a lot of challenges when you're trying to mold highly loaded fiber reinforced parts. So the injection molding, therefore, there's a limit of only like quarter inch fiber lengths. And sometimes if you really push it, you can go up to half an inch starting fiber length, right? So in the screw, that is, if you go back to this thing we talked about last time, so in this zone right here, you're feeding pellets which are, if you feed half an inch pellets here, as they migrate through the screw, what's happening? There's a lot of interaction of that fiber with respect to the shear wall of this, of the barrel, right? So the flight distance between the flights to the barrel, the fibers want to squeeze. In that process, they're going to start breaking, right? And so you get a lot of fiber attrition. That is, half an inch becomes quarter inch, becomes then smaller and smaller. So you're losing the advantage of the length of the fiber in that case. So every time you work with the injection molding operation with long fibers like these, you have to customize your screw so that the distance between the flight and the of the screw to the barrel is adjusted for one, and also the shape of this is, it has like a gradual shape as opposed to a shear shape. Most of the time the screw has a sharp edge to give it more shear, because that's how you actually reduce the viscosity of the polymer. But if you do the same thing with fiber reinforced polymers, you're going to get a lot of attrition and fiber breakage. Therefore, you have to very gently design the screw with enough clearance so that the fibers are free to move in that space and migrate down. The other change you then do is you have to first customize your screw, and a screw can cost between $8,000 to $10,000 for the customization. You then have to, instead of putting converging gates, usually you design it with diverging gates actually. And these are called as fan gates in injection molding. So these are fan gates. A fan gate would be like, it has a certain diverging behavior. So the idea is when the fibers come to that gate, they'll have more free path into the cavity. Otherwise, they will want to restrict and your flow will be affected. You can't fill the part fully. There are going to be a lot of challenges in that sense. So there are a lot of detailed design changes that have to be done when you migrate fiber-filled polymers into injection molded cavities, right? But the advantage of getting a fiber in the cavity is very significant, because if you look at a part, say, which has a geometry something like that, and you're molding here, what's going to happen? The fibers will directionally align in the direction of the flow, right? And therefore, your strength properties, your stiffness properties, all of them are going to go up in proportion. So when you want to increase the fiber, the composite strength, without making it in continuous fiber, you can use discontinuous fiber, but you can actually align it through the pressure of the injection using fan gates and getting the polymer with the fiber in place. Theoretically, in injection molding, you can pack up to 50% by weight, 50 weight fraction fibers. Beyond that, it becomes really difficult to push the melt pass because it becomes very solid, and then it's almost like pushing a highly viscous melt of a polymer, which doesn't flow at all. So there's a limit to which you can push the fiber into a part. But the goal is always to increase that weight percent, because the more structural the part is, the more fiber content you want. But what's the downside of high fiber content? Your surface will never be that shiny, clean, for example. You're going to have that rough, abrasive surface. That's from the high fiber content. So your structural properties and all that go up, but then the appearance can be compromised with that thing. And things like military parts and structural under the body, under the hood parts, they don't have to have appearance. They need to have a structure. Like if you look at a instrument panel for your car, you have the upholstery, which is soft touch, nicely covered, ABS and so on. You don't care what is behind it, right? What is really behind it is 40-50 weight fraction of fibers in glass fibers in polypropylene resin, which acts as the structural backbone for the instrument panel. You'd never notice it until you pull out all the upholstery and then look behind it. So many components use this to enhance, like bumper beams, floor under the floor covers. Like, I don't know, the PT Cruiser is not seen these days, but the entire floorboard of the PT Cruiser was a long fiber injection molded glass propylene part, 40-50 weight fraction of fibers in it, actually. So this has a lot of bearing on the properties. So if, and this is a well-known plot. If you were to plot the property, mechanical property, this could be strength, it could be stiffness, it could be impact toughness, and so on. And then if you plot processability on this side, right, and then if you look at this as being your fiber length and so on, it's well known that as this fiber length increases, so does your modulus, so does your strength, so does your impact toughness. All these properties go up, right? Because the fibers help these in terms of enhancing these properties. But if you look at processability, the processability acts in a inverse direction, because as more and more fibers get longer and longer, you cannot process them anymore as effectively. So your processing window for injection molding then is very narrow here for fiber loaded parts. It's generally in the range of 3 millimeters up to about 12 millimeters. With the understanding that the fiber starting fiber length would never remain the same at the end, right? And I think we have talked in other classes, but this particular thing is then referred to as fiber aspect ratio, where the fiber aspect ratio is length divided by the diameter of the fiber, as you can see. So if you consider, and I'm talking today more in composites form, but it's a plastics composites related topic here. So if you look at, let's say, typical length of the fiber, like let's, and you can do this calculation. If you think of a carbon fiber, I will ask you to look at, for example, let's assume they are all 12 mm in length, half an inch carbon, but the diameter of this fiber is what?
7 to 8
microns, right? It's basically 7 to 8 times 10 to the minus 6 meters. So now if you take the same in glass fiber right here, and then if you look at glass fiber length is what? Same 12 mm glass you take, but the diameter of the glass fiber is going to be in the ballpark of 12 to 15 microns. So it's obviously a fatter fiber comparatively as such. So right there, you can see as the diameter of this fiber gets less, the aspect ratio gets high, right? So which means in terms of carbon fiber, you don't need very long fibers because the diameter is already pretty small. So you may get a quarter inch carbon fiber or even 3 mm, and it reaches its critical length right away. So it means that if the fiber reaches a critical length, like if you were to look at this plot right here, this being your strength of the fiber, and this being your length of the fiber, for example. So if you look at this length right here, overall length of this fiber, you can see that it reaches its critical length here, which means your fiber has to be at least slightly longer than that critical length to transfer the interfacial stress between the fiber and the matrix. So carbon fibers are more, what is the strain to failure of carbon fiber, anyone knows? It's very small, right? Because it is very brittle. Carbon fiber can be less than 2%, which is very high actually. It's more like less than sometimes 0.1 to 1% strain to failure. It fails at a very low strain. If you look at glass fiber strain to failure, of especially S glass and glasses like that, it could be 3 to 5% strain to failure. So obviously glass is a lot more forgiving in impact, and carbon is less forgiving, but carbon doesn't have to be too long in the sense of the aspect ratio. So you can get high strength parts even with short carbon fiber in the part. So there's a very sweet spot here that you're looking at. So I'm saying all this because of the attrition that goes on in the part, and you've got to understand the role of attrition in that case. So tool design, in the context of tool design, what is important here is to understand what should be the shape of the runner, shape of the gates, and what material you are running through it in line with the extruder and the feed mechanism to the part. All that makes a difference in the final quality of your part. So this is, of course, an example of that. And you can see that the sprue looks like this. This is waste. The runner is waste. The gates, as it's entering, all this is waste. And from here on is your part, right? So basically, all this goes as waste, which gets recycled. And like I said, this is a polypropylene part to begin with. Polypropylene costs what? About 80 cents to a dollar a pound, based on what grade polypropylene. When you recycle that polypropylene, there is a whole economy there. People who just have business in recycling olefins, right? And they will resell it for 35 to 40 cents a pound. So you have, it's not a whole lot of retention of price, but it has a market regardless.
You feed it right back in your process too, depending upon your requirements.
Yeah, so when you feed recycled, if you make the same part, this it's the rule of thumb is to do a blend. You never put 100% recycled back. You always blend it with virgin material. So you may have 60% virgin, 40% recycled. For the reason that recycled material always develops hot spots and unknown areas which can cause thermal overshoots in the material because of its prior history. So to normalize that effect, you always mix recycled with some amount of virgin, unless the recycled part is for a very non-structural, it could be just a part to be there. Then you can use all recycled in that case. But typically in the, not to beleaguer this point, but the thermal history of the material depends on the polymer. Like olefins, them generally you can use them once or twice recycled. That is, you can shred, recycle, process, recycle. If you go for PPS or PEEK or higher in thermoplastics, you may go to 5-6 cycles of use, shred, reuse, shred, and still be fine. The material will not lose its properties at all. It will be very stable through those conditions. These I won't spend time, but this is just showing the sequence of feed. There is a reciprocating screw that reciprocates, right? And I think last class, in the last semester, we talked at length about these various zones. And you can see it's not a constant cross-section screw. It has a significant area for receiving the material. That's referred to as the metering zone, right? And then a feed zone. Then there is the metering zone, mixing zone, and then the dispense takes place. So as you go further up, the goal is to build up pressure to force the polymer into the cavity. So this crude design, again, like I was telling you about tooling, there's a very small body of experts who really understands crude design, and that is a very important skill set. And then, of course, like you see, the part ejects off. Here he shows it's with the sprue, and that's your scrap, essentially. We talked about this some sense last time, but there are many configurations to feeding. Sometimes the sprue is directly connected to the sprue bushing. Sometimes it's taken through a plate, two plates, and the hot runner. The main difference here, you can see that in all these cases, the sprue stays with the part when you have the plate. In the hot runner, what happens is it's a hot sprue and a hot runner, like the name says, right? You don't have to imagine too much. The hot runner means hot runner. So then the hot runner does not cool, so it does not leave the part, right? So it stays hot. So all you're doing is the part keeps falling, and then this stays because the next part is ready to be made right there. So this works very well for high volume things like bottle caps, toothbrushes, things, spoons and forks, and all the commodity items which are made in thousands of minutes. Like if you go to the NPE show in Orlando or something, and just stop by the Husky booth, right? Husky has a multi-story booth, and they are producing bottle caps. And those things are racing, the bottle caps are racing faster than Usain Bolt, right? It's very fast. It's just continuous production. It's like a second a cap like that. It's a very fast product. In those cases, it doesn't make sense to stop the sprue, then feed the next, keeping the sprue hot, and just keep producing. And you can recognize hot runner things by looking on the impression of the where it got ejected. You'll see a very small dot-like thing, like in cell phones or things like that. So it's very fine in that sense. Tool details, of course, I think we kind of talked about this. But injection tooling is a very complex construction. There's so much detail that goes into it. But some of the main points, like I said, most of them would have ejectors mechanism. And sometimes the ejector mechanism is applied from one system to the next. So you keep that as common with the base. And all you do is you can change your insert to mold the parts. These are the plates against which it's mounted to the machine. This is shown in a vertical mode, but usually it's a horizontally placed tool. I mean, there are vertical injection molders too, but usually they are horizontal. So this gives you some idea of the complexity of it. Usually you can build in holes and cutouts as part of your part to avoid secondary machining costs, for example. This one shows with all the ejectors showing, for example, and you can see the amount of complexity of this part right here. So these are the plates against which this would mount, and you can see the sprue would come into contact with the sprue bushing right here. So your extruder is out on this side of the part right here. Again, I think I mentioned this last time, P20, H13 are common materials when you look at injection tooling, right? So, and these are some more examples of the tools, and this is an hot runner system. Actually, you can see all the yellow part is where the polymer remains hot in the system. So the software that I will mention as part of the Autodesk itself is, and I'll go over it next class, but as long as you have your part design made, the software will go ahead and fully assemble the tool for you, including the ejector locations. All you have to give is diameter of the ejectors, the length of the ejectors, and certain basic geometry of the ejectors. And then the tool base is sized for you based on the part itself. How much should the length of the tool be, height of the tool be, what is the volume, and so on. And based on that, you don't have to CAD every single detail on the tool itself. The inserts, the ejectors, base plates, all of them are like pulling a screw design from CAD and just putting that in. It's just like that. You just call out that base. There's already CAD models that exist. You just pull it up for that respective part. So if you do this professionally, you would spend very little time on the actual male-female cavities, right? Once your part design is ready, it's a matter of quickly assembling the rest from known files, for example. So that's a very good convenience, if you will. Like I said, glass fiber and so on have a very large effect on the small areas like this because of continuous abrasion. So the art of tool repair is again, it's an economy of its own. People just specialize on that and take on jobs just to do. It's a very lucrative business, obviously, because if the production is at stake, people can pay any amount of dollars to get the tool back on the press, right? If it sits away from that, you're losing money. So every minute lost, you're losing a dollar. So that's where sometimes these people work under extreme stress because the tool is shipped to them overnight. They have to turn it back the same day sometimes. Right? So there's a lot of, although the money is good, there's a lot of detail and ability to understand whether it should be welded. Sometimes if there's a pit or something, you can weld the pit and then you can clean that and bring it back to shape, right? So there is a lot of welding that is accompanying this. And this is where additive manufacturing is now making its way as well in terms of repair. They could be quickly additively repaired patches till you get past your production now, for example. So let's skip this because this is optimization of the process. So you can, of course, calculate the overall tonnage you need for actually running a part simply by having some idea of what would be the total area of cross-section that you're filling, what would be the typical pressure of injection, and from that you know that what press capacity that you will need, what kind of short size you need to fill a part, and that from that you'll say, okay, if I do two cavities, I have about a 420 ton force in there, at least I need an 800 ton press to make that part. So when you don't overkill and kill an ant with a hammer, right? But sometimes when you're making very small parts, you don't need that big of a molding tonnage press. You can go for maybe a 20 ton, 40 ton. But if you're trying to make a larger part, you should be able to position your press on the machine size with respect to the size of the part. Where that becomes important, again, you're running 5,000-10,000 parts, it's the economy, right? How much are you paying per part? And the injection molding people price things by the hour. So how many hours, what energy consumption on which machine. So obviously you want to optimize your machine when you're running a certain size part. So there, anyone knows what an injection molding machine per hour costs roughly? Right. Not new, but you go out and get contract work done. It's not very bad at all. It may be about, it ranges from about $40 to about $200 per hour. It just depends on how many, how complex the part is, how much operators, time, and so on.
I have a question. When you inject the material into the mold, and how do you get out the air which already inside the mold? Because I think I'd imagine that there will be some bubble or the back pressure.
That's a great question. Usually the polymer, is pushing the air out, right? Uh-huh. You're entering the polymer, so you are venting on the tool.
So there's a venting hole or
yes,
a purge hole
yes,
in the mold.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, real small, usually you're talking on the order of 10,000ths of an inch for vent space.
Uh-huh.
And you can play with that depending upon the speed of injection affects it as well, and then how the part fills.
Okay.
So you have to figure out the window. It's not just one setting. It's a window that you get within based on your part geometry.
Okay.
All right. And these are the holes like you see on your coffee cup to push the air out.
Okay.
It's like pinholes.
Okay.
So sometimes you'll see flats. You'll see like four flats
right.
arranged equally around a diameter. If it doesn't work, you put scotch tape on the face.
So yeah, the machine cost, as you can see, clamping force and machine cost, right? I mean, as you increase your clamping force, of course, your dollars per hour is going to go up based on tonnage. So tonnage is going to dictate. So if you can do a part at, let's say, clamping force of 4 kilonewtons, whatever tons that comes to, but when you start using, you can certainly do it on a 10 kilonewton molding machine, but then you're paying that much more for it for no reason. So you have to be very careful in that type of thing. The other thing that happens in these parts are these defects that happen, and you've probably seen this in things like the cold and weld lines or sink marks. A good weld line example is a cell phone case, of course, where you're punching your numbers. You can see the amount of cutouts in this, and in this case, always it's economical to make it with the cutouts as opposed to post-machining. So based on where you get the part, and where in this case is yellow point is where the polymer is entering, and you can see that, and as when I do the FEA and all, I spend some time on mold flow, of course, you can see the part is gated there, it's entering the tool cavity, and then as it starts filling, when you have streams of polymer from both sides coming to a point, that is called as a weld line, right? That's where the two flowing streams meet. Now, there's a lot of debate on what kind of defects that provides. Sometimes you can fully avoid the weld lines. Sometimes you cannot, just on the geometry. You have to minimize them. And to his question, like he just asked, in these cases, sometimes you have to position your vents such that the idea is to push those weld lines out and then get the air out of the part. When you have very thin parts with relative to the rib heights, like here, you can see that this is the base and these are the ribs. You can start getting the ribs being so tall, start exhibiting a tensile stress on the surface, so your material starts getting pulled inwards, and that's referred to as a sink mark. So if you see very thin, badly made parts, like toys and so, it's a good example, you can see there's not much quality control. There's always some pulling of the material at those locations, right? And that is for two reasons. There is a certain geometry, like typically if this is 3T, the rule of thumb is the rib should be about 3T. That is, if your rib height is, and also the width of the rib has a certain relationship, right? So if you look at infant seats, is a good example. If you look on the back of infant seats, for safety, it's highly gridded, right? It has a lot of ribs, like grid ribs, very thin ribs, but they're very deep ribs. So therefore, you see, to avoid the sink marks, usually this base is made slightly thicker in those cases so that you don't get those weld lines, I mean, sink marks. That is the problem. Sink marks, of course, if it's a high-precision parts, are unacceptable. Of course, you have to get rid of them. But if the part is non-cosmetic, etc., you can work with less material, save on material, and live with that defect. But usually, that is from the differential ratio of the ribs to the base. That's more of a quality control thing, just so that you have to keep track of this. So here he is, forgot to say this, here he has high shrink and low shrink simply by changing the width of the rib, right? He's able to change the amount of shrink in the material. So there are several designing rules that you follow when you position of the rib, height of the ribs, intersection of the ribs, relative height with respect to the base. So those are all the factors. And now when you add polymer with fiber in it, actually it helps. When you have knit polymer tends to shrink more because of tendency to go to minimum energy. When it's fiber filled, and more fiber filled, you can start getting lesser and lesser sink in it. But then it's more challenging to fill thinner ribs with fiber. So there is a compromise that you have to go through. Then in injection molding, they use a lot of such features to take advantage of the ability to fill complex geometry and add stiffness to the part. You never stiffen an injection molded part by making it thicker. What do? You add strategically placed ribs, you add bosses, this is called a boss. When you add a wing to it, that's called a gusset, right? So gusset and bosses is a way you can look at. If you open your remote control cover and look inside the thing, you will see that's how all the rigidity is gained. It's a thin part, but it's very rigid. How is it made so rigid? By adding gussets, bosses, and ribs strategically placed. These are called steps where the part changes its geometry like so. And then this is a good example. You can see that these are referred to as plastic hinges or snap fits. You can see that when you connect like a lunchbox is a good example, right? You bring it, and then same thing when you want to open it, you open it with a plastic. So it has a plastic hinge behavior, so you don't have to have a hard hinge. It just has enough ductility in the joint to take that much fatigue cycles of opening and closing like so. So this snap fits are common in plastic parts. They are probably more readily incorporated in injection molding because you don't have to weld them later or do any of that. In metals, this would be very hard to integrate, right? You have to do a lot of post-welding and things like that. So that's the beauty of it. Injection molded parts can be made very complex with all those features added. But this is a good example of how many features are dumped into this part to make it stiff, rigid, at the same time, economical from material usage standpoint. So the other thing I forgot to mention is you do provide drafts in the part. What is draft, of course? So draft means if I have a part which is like that, and this is 90 degrees, what happens when I'm trying to remove this part every time? It always has a catch point here, right? Because it does not want to come off easily. So the part is going to stick to the tool, and you're fighting with it with hammer and nails and so on. That's not the best way of production, right? You want to be sure that the part comes out every time. So what do you typically do? You always give it some amount of a draft angle, which means you kind of don't make it 90, make it what is called as plus 2 to 3 degrees in addition to that angle. So 92, 93, like that, right? So when you do that, what happens now? The part cannot stick because it's continuously tapering. And it's such a small taper that it doesn't really affect your function or anything normally. So you always provide, you can put in the CAD, for example, what is your draft angle. But typical values of 2 degrees, 3 degrees are very common. When the part is very sticky or elastomeric, that kind of thing, then you have to be more generous in your draft, like 4 or 5 degrees is probably a very high value for a draft angle, but it's generally in that small range. That's what this draft angle means. Then there is this term called undercuts. I think I explained that in the helmet video, I suppose. Undercut means like if you have something going like that, and then suddenly there is a change in geometry inwards, right? Then what happens if you're trying to pull this part out? You can't pull it out because that's going to come in the way. So what do? You need something that is there to mold the part. When it's finished molding, you need it to slide out of the way and therefore open up that gap. Now you can pull that part out. So designing for undercuts is possible, but done all the time, but it does add to your mold cost because now you have to cams to pull it out, you need springs to push it out. So you have many mechanical actions in the tool, and the more you build in that and you have a small real estate to work with, then you have to make sure that precision machining, all those small component assemblies add cost to the part. So that's why tooling with undercuts is more expensive actually.
For some things you can, depending upon the resin, you can strip out small undercuts.
It's very
pretty
true.
Pretty easily, and if you orient your polish lines on your tool,
sure,
or you segment it so the hoop stress is reduced, you can get away with it to a certain extent.
That's a good point. So crystalline polymers or fiber reinforced materials are tough to push out, but like Stephen is saying, like elastomers or moderately flexible polymers, you don't need to worry. Then you can almost ply it open, right, because it has enough flex in it to ply it open. Then standard tools can be do, and they do it all the time. It's not like undercuts every time have to have sliders, but it very much depends on the material condition. You got to see if it is enough to pull it out or so on. Like putting a gasket, right, you have to work it in and then you can pull it out. Sometimes it's the same idea for the moment. So these are some rules. You want to hide part weld lines, you want to avoid sharp corners. Holes can be molded like two-thirds the way. This is called as knockoffs in the tool. So generally what happens, let's say my part is like this. And we had a part, for example, like that. And we had a part like that. And it has two slots here, and then it has a slot here like that. So this part, almost like a face, right? So basically, if you look at it, so this is, you don't mold the part like completely with the holes in it. What do you do? If you look at the this portion right here, and this thickness, overall thickness, let's say is T, and this part would be molded at about, you know, two-thirds of T or something like that. It's a lower thickness. So what happens, the part is very thin, so it's, and why is it not molded with the holes in it? Because of this whole weld lines that can come and start changing the flow direction. You mold it as a continuous surface or continuous part, and then later, because it's so thin, you can just knock off those with a punching tool. All you do is take it to the punching tool and just it just plays knocks off all the time. So that's done a lot as well, where you can cheat the system by not building all these complexities, because each of these features in the tool is going to add cost, right? That way you avoid the cost, you just make that portion shallow and thin, and then you can knock it off. Yes, sir?
You said on the cell phone example that you want to do more of an injection mold and build your mold to look like that, but it seems like wouldn't it be easier to do sort of a punch situation in this case? So
that,
how do you know which to do and which situation is better for you?
That's a good point again. So what happens is, it all depends on how many features you're working with, right? In the injection molded cell phone thing, you have 9, 10, related to the size of the part, the hole sizes are, I mean, it's quite a sizable hole area there. So the forces of the punch acting on that, etc., is enough to start cracking the material locally as well. So the quality control of doing that is probably going to cause more rejects than the amount of weld lines for that thickness that you can do. So there is no one answer for that. It really depends on how many features you want to knock out. Usually when it is few features only in a bigger part, the knockoff works very well. Also flow distance matter. When you're doing larger parts, you have more flow distance in the part. So every time you have cutouts built in the tool, you get a lot more diverging flows in the part, right? So it's a balance between that fluid mechanics, the relative aspect ratio of the part, and the aspect ratio of the features. So I don't have one answer for you, unfortunately, but it's a mix of all of those. So anyway, this is all about injection molding. Well, I hope you got some more appreciation of the complexity involved and the beauty of a final product, right? So then let's move our attention to compression tooling. Very different animal, of course. When you look at compression tooling, you're talking about processes like forging and stamping in metals, for example, or in, go ahead, Vivek.
Compression
molding, yeah. And that's exactly what I said. No, I'm saying that this is, like sheet molding compound, charge sheets, I mean, there's anything that you can place in there and then bring the tool and close it and flow, that is compression molding. So several things to notice on compression. This is, I think, an automotive part, more like a seat, maybe a seat or even a module, like a tailgate kind of module. But here, if you look at this tool, one thing is you can see the machine paths are still captured in there. They don't worry about cleaning those up. But the contact area of the tool is highly clean, of course. This surface in the compression molding is very critical. The vertical walls Because in compression, what happens is you are bringing the male down into the female, but in that process, you're not able to apply the same forces on the vertical walls, right? Because all your forces are acting downward. So the part has a challenge, for example, to have the same compaction on this surface as opposed to this surface. So in that process, you always get differential thinning, differential thickness of those as in terms of the how much material movement you get. But injection molding is not a problem. You have a fixed cavity. The polymer forces into that cavity. That's why you need that much tonnage to keep things together and then push them out. Here it's a dynamic cavity, right? Because the cavity is first that high, then it starts closing, and fully closes out. So in that dynamic nature of it, the ability to keep local part thicknesses the same is the challenge. So there's a lot of detail that goes into building the drafts on those walls to give it sufficient lateral compaction while you're doing vertical.
Just a side note, I guess that's a machine piece of metal, right?
Huh?
Is that a piece of metal?
Yeah, it's a chunk of metal. That's why these tools are very expensive. So this tool in aluminum even could be like a 60 to 80K tool, right?
So you think the guy's telling the other guy to lift with his knees to pick that up?
Maybe that's what he's saying. Exactly.
Don't lift with your back.
I think he's saying...
He's saying use a composite is what I guess he's saying. Okay. But yeah, like Richard is saying, these things usually have a gantry crane, which is picking up tools and moving them around. It's not a single person job by any means. But they're very, I've seen tool changes at like Magna and places like that. They do this big tool change in 20 minutes. They're producing one set of parts. It's out of the, and most of these are floor mounted. The press, the bottom platen is level with the floor. It's not even at the height. So all the reaction is being taken at the floor. So usually if you go with standard foundations, 8-inch or so, this won't work, right? You've got to have at least industrial foundations. In some cases, you have to dig a pit in the ground to take all the reaction loads in there. So that's why.
Yeah. When you say it won't work, then it'll just go right through the floor?
It's going to crack your floor. It's going to damage your structure, right? Building structure.
It won't be level anymore.
Yeah, it's going to start, the life of the floor will be in question there, obviously. The safety issues. So as this says, one of the key things in automotive particularly uses is what is called a sheet molding compound. And sheet molding compound is essentially glass fibers which are mixed in very viscous resin. And then they're forming sheets of that, like it looks like tacky rubber sheets, if you will. That's the best analogy there. But they are very much resin filled with fiber sheets. And we do work here with sheet SMC all the time. So in this case, what happens, the charge is placed, like this is the charge. Generally, like I said, this has a generous draft here, no question. The other thing you may notice is engaging pins. Usually they have diagonal pins on the tool. They don't put four pins because there's always some risk of trying to put four pins and getting them to match. You put one pin on that corner and one on this corner. Always the length of the pin has, in this case it's a wrong diagram, the length of this pin has to exceed the height of the part. Actually the pin length has to be at least out here. Why? You don't want the tool surfaces to start mashing and stuff like that. You want this pin to come first into contact with that, right? And then once that engages, and then the tool starts closing in and completely closing the cavity. Now, some of the challenges with this, of course, if you look at an aluminum tool here, your pins cannot be made out of aluminum because aluminum is deforming material no matter how strong it is. So your pins always are built on a bearing, and they are steel pins. Actually, there's a bearing like here, a steel bearing, and then a steel pin so that when it engages, usually these are 3/4 inch or thicker, taller, fatter. So you'll see in tools you have these fat engaging pins, and that's because the tool is made robust through that. So when these start engaging, then the rest of the cavity starts closing in on it. So in these type of presses or operation, one of the platens is, this is called a platen, which is generally where the tool is placed. This platen has is in one case is non-movable, that's it's a fixed platen, and in one case the other side platen is the movable platen, right? So this is the movable portion of it. Sometimes you do build these kind of extra head boxes and so on for transferring of load, but there's all kinds of configurations that can go. The other thing is these platens could be heated platens, which means you already have, how are they heated? Generally you have heating holes, and in lower temperature applications you have plumbing lines with them, copper lines that go in and out, and then you connect it to what is called as a thermulator. So the thermulator is circulating oil, for the most part oil heated, and then there are of course steam heated presses too, but then your oil is circulating. And the oil is, as it heats up, it builds up enough mass to heat the tool, right? And that's what is becomes the way to... And why do you need heat? Because these materials are usually heat activated. And until you get to a certain temperature, they will not start cross-linking. Like we saw in the polymer discussion, all the spaghettis have to come and start bonding. That's what happens when you start the heat. Of course, heat is a energy consumer, so you have to... be concerned about the energy costs of heating. So oil heating works well all the way for generally for materials like polypropylene, polyethylene, epoxy parts, polyester, vinyl ester, things like that, right? But the minute you go to nylons and upwards of that up to peak, here now you're talking about much higher temperatures. So oil heating then starts falling short of, it cannot do the job. In that case, you do what is called as gun drill the tool. You would put a long drill, and then wherever you have the holes, you can think of additional holes to put in what is called as cartridge heaters. So these are electrical cartridge heaters, right? And these are basically all connected to a box. There's a resistance then. It starts building up heat in the tool through the electrical energy as opposed to thermal energy from the oil, for example. So cartridge heaters then can take the tool up to 700 to 800 F, which is typical of most, unless you're doing ceramics, it's typical of most materials that you can mold in this range. So tooling can be on the platen, like I said. Generally tooling, there are, if platens have heat on them, the presses can be expensive. But there can be heat on the tool as well, right? So so I may have mixed up what I said, but in this case, the heat could also be on the tool. So in this case, you don't have to heat the platens, your tool is heated. So at the end of each tool, you will see there's like a plumbing connection, an NPT connection, which just goes through a quick disconnect and connect hose. That is meant for plumbing the tool to the hydraulics, actually. Most of the time. That's how you heat, you're circulating your oils and so on. So your thermulator unit has this pipe which feeds to the tool. The tool is plumbed. So all you do is pull the one tool out, put the next one in, and plumb it. So therefore, it's very economical to do what in this case when you're doing large parts? It's very economical to do cast tooling, right, as opposed to machine tooling, because when you're able to cast a tool, let's say you're trying to make a roof of a bus, use complex part like that. Now if you try to make a tool like a machine metal, like you're just saying, the cost of that tool would be exorbitant. Yeah. But then if you're able to cast in your lines in a sand cast mold and just pour your metal, you can build that tool at almost a third of the cost of producing it in a machine fashion. So cast tooling is very common in the industry. You will find that everything is rough except the contact surfaces are just machined. Everything else is rough. They don't care about appearance of the rest of the thing in there. So tooling, again here, several classes. You can go with aluminum for limited parts, meaning up to 5,000 for the size of 24 by 24. You can go to steel, different grades of steel. Or you can also go to cast aluminum or cast steel. So there's a whole body of tool makers who do one or the other of these. But compression is another widely used process, and you should be familiar with that. Here are some examples. Again, they're in the plastics world, but you can see the type of shapes and sizes you can compression mold, right? So in this particular case, these are all, you can see complex ribbing, there's a requirement of a finish, there's all of these backside structural requirements. These are some complex parts with some post-machining has been done. Inserts have been added. Sometimes you can put inserts in the tool and then mold over it so that they become integral. Like John Deere, when they make all the tractor hoods, are made with inserts. Like you have a robot that presses eight inserts, the charge is placed and then compression molded. So all the inserts now, then the robot comes, trims off the flash, and the part is close to ready. The painting, it goes through one painting operation actually. Here you can see like these are over-molded parts, like we work in the lab here. So you have a structure behind this, which is made of some kind of a continuous fabric, and then you over-mold the complex part of it using a sheet molding compound. So you can do very creative things with this particular process, obviously, in this case. The other thing you may notice is there is a finish on this part, right? So where is that finish coming from? Like when I showed you the... I didn't show you that. Oh yeah, injection molded. You have a beautiful finish because there is enough pressure on the system to migrate, right? Coatings, and also it is the finish on the tool. So what I forgot to mention, that this tool, of course it's aluminum, but if it were a steel tool, you can put a chrome finish on this coating or chrome finishing. And every part then will look like a mirror shine, right? You can look through it and it will beautifully shine. It will be that. If you want a leathery look, like a textured look, which many parts have, like your chair is leathery, right? So that was made because the tool had texture built into it. So the minute you mold the part, every part has the texture that it captures. So whatever is the tool, if somebody forgot a screw in the tool, every single part is going to show that screw in the tool because now it has that impression. So every part you make, they do that. But companies do their logos in the tool, they cut it out, so every part you make, the material flows to that, it becomes your signature for that part. So it's used, the finish of this tool could be tailored number of ways, from very fine to matte finish to textured finishes. And if you want to, sometimes you put a film in it and mold over it. So that film, let's say if you're a UT fan, you'd have a UT logo in the film, and then you mold behind it. So every part has it. You don't have to do it in a post-secondary operation. Sometimes, like you did in injection molding, you have a variation of compression molding called transfer molding. So in this case, the tool is designed such that you have a location to put the charge, so you have some uniformity of the charge created there. Then you push it through entry points where it goes and fills the cavity. So there is a, this is a holding station, if you will, where a charge is made, positioned, and therefore you don't put the charge and get a lot of flash, etc. You can minimize all that by monitoring the transfer port for what is required. So it's just a variation. It's compression molding, but just slightly different.
Where do you see that used? I'm not familiar with that.
So that's used a lot when you're doing fast cycle time parts, again, which may have a lot of rips or complex geometries, where you may end up putting a variation from charge to charge. And there's a cycle time, the press is still waiting for when there's a differential in the cycle time versus feed from the charge coming in. You need like a holding station, and that's what this does. Sometimes they swivel out of the way, in and out. Sometimes there's like a shuttle press. One is producing, the other is charging, comes in, so it's kind of a shuttle press, right? One is loading, the other is charging like that. So this...
heating may or may not be necessary. You can have plastic that is in solid form that you just push it in through those holes.
Yeah, in this case, the viscosity is in the order of 10,000 and upward centipoise. What you're referring to certainly is done, but it is more like a thermoforming operation, where the sheet never melts. Just stackifies, it just drawn into shape. That works for parts which are moderately shallow and everything, but when you have tight radii, complex parts, then it has to have, the molten material works a lot better, or less viscous. So this is a long fiber process. Again, here, this is something we use in our lab quite a bit. So the basic difference here is you have a lot of fibers that are added to the resin here. So the material is in the form of pellets, actually. So these pellets are more like pultruded pellets or hot melt impregnated pellets. So the fiber runs the entire length of the pellet here. So in this case, if you took a 25 millimeters pellet, it is the fiber length is 25 all the way. That's the big, as opposed to a compounded material where you can have the same type of pellet, but the fibers are chopped fibers, right? So you can get a pellet of that length, but the fibers in that is much, much smaller, actually. So the advantage of long fiber here is that the L by D is greater than 1500 for the most part, so it's really strong fibers then. So they get filamentized and homogenized in this, what we call as a plasticator here. And then this material is knifed off at the end. Usually have like a guillotine knife which cuts it to a certain charge size. The charge looks like a ball of hay. You can section it to any distance or length. And that gets transferred either manually or robotically to the press. In our case, our robot is called Pritesh. Grad student, but in sense of it's manually done, right? But in the industry, this would be in line. You'll have a robot going back and forth. And this press then comes down, discharged with all the fibers, flows, and fills the parts. So you can get very complex shape parts, which are near net shape and everything. So this is now heavily used in automotive industry and for all your. And auto industry, as you know, is very polypropylene friendly because of the cost of the material, the glass and the resin. So this is just the base process. In companies like Diefenbacher and Engel and Arberg in Germany and Austria, they're pioneers in this technology. They have added what is called as a DLFT to it, which is like a direct LFT. So they don't even come to this step of pelletizing the material. They just feed direct fiber spools. This fiber just comes straight to the extruder, right? So while it is extruding right there, the fiber is being chopped and fed right there, and then the polymer comes at the same time. So they're blending and doing the step what this is normally done in the plasticator. So the material is already plasticized as it goes, and then it continuously feeds to the robot, actually. So they fully eliminated one big giant step of hot melt impregnating of the pellets. They will come directly. So a company like Owens Corning or PPG may send in their rolls in a truck. While they are sitting in the truck itself, they are pulled into the extruder and it's continuously processed. So you reduce your cycle times dramatically and make it very effective as well. So this is a very growing process. Right now it's limited to olefins, but now it's been extended to nylons and other crystalline materials. So direct LFT challenges of other heavier polymers or engineered polymers is the wet out. Polypropylene tends to wet out better with this, in this, but you cannot take nylons or TPU or other materials and wet them in the same way. So there is a technical challenge that is being overcome in that. So. But tooling on this is very similar to SMC tooling that I showed you. For example, these are some tools we have in our labs. One of the things we do is we have to eject, and ejection adds a lot of cost to the tool. We just, in this case, use discs, which are fairly like almost 2-inch disc in this case, or 1-inch, I think, discs. Which you can manually, you can pull the part, and it's like a lever action, all the pins come up, and that's what pushes the part out, actually. So this real estate below this tool is all for ejection right here. That's how it is made. You may also notice this tool has stops on it. These kind of bars are called stops on the tool. And the purpose of those stops are what? So the male comes. It has a hard stop there, correct? It stops there. It means if you're building a half an inch part, every time if you want the part to be half an inch, in injection molding, no problem, your cavity is fixed. Here you are bringing that tool to a hard stop, so no matter what happens below it, the part is always going to come out at that thickness of half an inch. So this way you get With the tool, you get different size stops, or sometimes they use shims. Shims are also quite fine to use in there, and that's one way to address this thing. Here, again, notice this tool will give you what I was saying. This is the hard bearing to receive the engaging pin, which then goes with that. So that's some of the features of the compression tool. And this is an example of the plate that we make, how it comes off right after the ejector acts, the plate can be pushed out. Otherwise, without the ejector, you can imagine going in there trying to, it's not fun, really, when you've done that as well. There are other tools, like sometimes customers do, is these are interchangeable tools. Actually, this tool can be used both in injection molding and in compression molding. So you have a gate in the tool which can be plugged in or plugged out based on how you use it. So you can take it from an injection molding press and put it into a compression molding press. This particular tool, again, you can see the stops there very nicely shown. This has hydraulic cylinders as ejectors. It basically pushes through hydraulic action as opposed to manual. And this part is more of a representative part to pull out ASTM tensile coupons for tension, flex, isod impact. So one tool can generate all the test coupons you need for qualifying your material. So sometimes when you're working a big project, you want to see how your material does in all these tests. So you have one tool that just produces all the coupons in one shot. Right? So once you mold this, you have all these coupons that you make in one shot. So the molded parts from that look something like this. So this is how the map of the samples would be. That's an actual, and here you can see the plumbing lines I was telling you in the tool. You can see those for heating, cooling. Those are the stops on the tool. And here, this part's made with, this is glass polypropylene. You can see it has those nice shaped ribs. Here also we were challenging the tool to look at how thick this rib should be. This is thin, thick, medium. This is converging so that all the material is trying to force in there. So in this tool, we were also evaluating the fiber flow and how much restriction will it allow or not. You would know right away if you got more resin content here that that's a limit of this particular process, right? So it's in one tool, you could quickly evaluate a range of your process options. How does this become important? Because this you can tell your customer, for this part, this is possible, this is not, this is the weight fraction we can get. And then they can use that data in their design and build their structural models based on this information. So it's a very helpful exercise. This is the same part in carbon fiber here, nylon, right? And this is glass polypropylene. So it's very material friendly.
How many attempts out of that? Are those tensile specimens?
Yeah, they are not your full, but they are smaller. There is an ASTM we can also accept.
But what I'm saying is, how's it, that star pattern? How do you get tensiles out of that?
Yeah, you're going to lose some. I mean, you're going to basically, this is to look at different orientations.
Oh, I get you. Okay.
So when you want to see this orientation, you look
so it's just
at
one that specimen you actually get out of.
You're not okay getting the CTS. That would be difficult. Well, we could try, but no, it won't work. That is to look at orientation effort.
Yeah.
Okay, almost there. So the other thing you should note, this is also a tool which can do compression molding of SMC, LFT. But this surface also is telling you vertical wall. The other thing is the way the material comes into contact, when the top, the male comes into contact with the female and where they close in at that gap, that is referred to as a shear edge. So shear edge is the point at which the, like the name suggests, shear edge. What does a shear edge do? I mean, your knife is a, your scissor is a shear edge, right? When you bring them in contact, it's going to cut the material. So same thing happens here when they, if the shear edge is like the shape of a knife point, then when as soon as the surfaces come in contact, it's going to cut off all the flash that is generated. So the part is already beautifully finished by the time it is done. So you don't have to go back with a router to clean it or automated fashion. But the challenge with the shear edge is, because it is so sharp, every time if you're using glass fiber and so on, this thing wants to start dulling, just like a shear will, a scissor will dull after some time. So the more abrasive the material is, the more challenging it is to maintain that shear edge, which means you go take it back to that repair guy I showed you, and he has to keep, like you take a scissor to a grinding wheel, but in the same analogy here, talking about a complex shape, trying to manage that shear edge. So there is a fine balance with coming to a zero point or allowing a small radius of contact to see what is acceptable or not. But there's a big detail, which is generally not appreciated, how detailed that is to design that shear edge in the part. So that is,
Do they do that often in mass production, shear edges on the form molds?
Again, depends on the part where it's used, right? If it is a...
Typically, wouldn't you see, like, forming and then punching?
Yeah, so again, Dylan, like, for him, there's no one answer, because it's right. Very volume dependent, right? If you're doing millions of parts, you would certainly invest in the shear edge, because that will avoid all your labor cost of post-training. If you're doing only thousands of parts, it may be more economical to do that extra step versus investing, because this can add a significant cost to your part. But it is, in production parts, this is a very... a much volume-driven detail that needs to be taken into account. So this particular part is something we, of course, made here. So we have, this is not made here, but it's our tool, right? So you can see the daylight opening. This is called the daylight opening of the press, which means when the top and the bottom is at their extreme positions, how much daylight does the press see? So this is about 40 inches of daylight. So when you're mounting tall parts, which have differential heights, you need a press with a large daylight opening. When you're doing skinny parts, you don't need the daylight opening to be that high. So that adds to the height of your press as well. So in this case, you can see also the engaging pins are much more robust, right? And they're always lubricated here, as you see, because they're going to see a lot of friction contact from this case. So in this case, these parts were molded. This is from continuous, what is called as a wood stock polypropylene. A lot of automotive interior parts use natural fibers like wood stock, etc., because of ability to dispose them at end of life. So this is fully biodegradable or recyclable mat, so it has the consistency of a felt to begin with, but when it's consolidated, it is stiff and strong. This was made from what is a material called Asdel, which is glass fibers with polypropylene resin. Again, it's like a felt. When it's consolidated, it becomes very stiff. And based on how much you consolidate, you can make it that much denser in this particular case. So these are some things about compression tools. Like I said, wood is a very low-cost alternative for molding parts. Of course, wood, you can't have the high compression process, I said, which works very well with thermoforming and processes such as those, because there's very much, it captures all your geometry, it has the high heat resistance. So for doing intermediate scale prototyping work, wood is a very good alternative. So what I'll do is, since this is a very interesting thing further, so I don't want to take too many classes, so I'll record, I guess, one lecture to continue this and finish up the tooling part and post that, so that we'll cover that tooling as tooling. And next class, at least, I'll go complete again and show how some of this actually goes into CAD and how that works. And so, closing the loop on the CAD part. Any questions or comments before we start?